Welcome back. This is the SMG Blacklist Podcast, episode number 15, The Judge. I'm one of your hosts, Jacqueline Grosky, and with me is...
Melissa Maxey.
Here we were talking about this episode, and Melissa, you said, hey, just, I'm still kind of watching it, and she said, hey, just fast forward to the end.
Yeah, it's the best part.
So we're going to do this live right on the show. I've just hit play, and they're playing an old hit called Jolene. And now Tom is sitting there playing with his wedding ring. Oh, and now he pops it off.
Tom.
And Tom's got, like, these, like, little puppy dog eyes that he gets. And, of course, now he's walking down the hall.
I love this part.
Staring up at the bed with her forlorn eyes.
Oh, yeah.
She sits up as if she can hear him coming down the hall. Oh, and they flash back to the jail. And, of course, you know, now the judge has been caught.
Because it's the end of the show. At the beginning of the show.
But, of course, you know, she's got total respect now at the prison. So he uses the key.
Yeah, he uses the key.
Jolene's like, hey.
She's like, hey, baby.
Bam. He comes to tell her that he can't.
Oh. Wrong answer.
The anticipation.
Elizabeth Keene is not your wife. She's your target.
She's my wife.
She's not your wife. She's your target.
Yes!
Did they send you? Really? To what? Test me. I told you that I was in love with her because that is exactly
what is he
what
saying?
I was supposed to be.
Oh, wow! It's my job to love her.
It's my job to love her.
Wow!
Yes! We know the answer!
So, but I don't think that Jolene was sent by them. She's as a, you know, that she's, like, this is coming off as a test. I think she just pried the answer that we've been looking for.
Yes. So, Jolene, in this episode, a lot of things were revealed about her. He hired, or what's the guy's name that he?
Oh, the guy in the black hat.
Yeah, the guy in the black hat. Which?
Oh gosh, I can't remember, but he's definitely, you know, he's definitely a guy he's used before and can find anybody. But he says, "Look, I don't want you to find him. I want you to find Jolene. I want you to find where she's been."
Yes.
And he literally finds everything. It's got the hard, you know, little the flash drive and...
What? So the guy in the black hat was also in Fringe. I love him. Lance Reddick is his name.
Ah.
And I think that this role that he's playing, you know, as Red's, you know, having him search for stuff was pretty perfect for him.
Yeah, it's cool.
And
I could see him coming back as a recurring character every once
in
a while.
Oh, I hope so. I hope that that's what they're doing because I like him a lot.
Yeah.
So it's pretty cool, the stuff that he finds out.
Oh, yeah.
About Jolene. All of her identities, and he can see where she's been. She's following a pattern. It looks like she's been in the same place as Red has been, too. Like, she's following him around. Kind of gives us an idea that, you know, she's definitely using Tom and Liz to get to Red.
Right.
Get to him.
Well, like you said, either she's looking for a bunch of little targets or one big one. And, of course, you know, we flash back to where Red has been to each of those locations mm-hmm. in just about every instance. So that's huge.
Yeah, so that was a pretty good reveal. You know, a lot of stuff revealed in this episode.
So, yeah, that just proves she's not – whoever Tom is working for, she's not part of that. She's looking for Red. And, of course, she disappeared. She faked her death to get Red off of her trail.
Yeah.
And so, you know, we don't know quite. Is there a familial thing here, or is there really something else going on? But now she's really on Red's track.
Yeah, he wants to watch what she's doing. He tells, you know, the guy in the hat to, you know, just watch her, not to do anything about it until he finds out what she's up to.
Right. So Jolene really puts the cards on the table all for Tom when Tom doesn't go for the... you know, oh, I'm really married, and it's like, so, you know, at this point, why not get together? You know, it's okay as long as I know your story. You know, of course, he may be, you know, feel a little hurt or misled, so maybe that's the end of Tom and Jolene.
Makes me wonder about Tom's role. I mean. And maybe he's protecting her. Maybe some other, like, faction is having Liz be protected, you know? And I don't think that Tom works for Reddington, obviously. We just the stuff that's happened in the previous episodes, we don't see that. I don't see that. I mean, do you?
No, but I do, you know, he's got that, you know, that Alan Alda, that came out backwards. The Alan Alda group that is it working in the background seems to be like they work on a parallel track, and they've been, you know, they've been keeping track of Red's, you know, making sure that, you know, he's keeping secrets, and Tom could be part of that. Which, don't forget, that is a government faction.
Yes.
And so Tom could be on the government side, but keeping track on what Liz is doing to keep an eye.
Well, and he's trying to keep her out of whatever Red's doing, because he's doing everything he possibly can to keep her from working with Reddington, besides coming out and saying, don't work with him.
Right.
I mean, she's like trying to get her to have a baby and settle down. I mean, you know, go on trips with him where she's not at work. You know, he doesn't want her to be at work. He doesn't want her to go down this path that she's going. It's like he's trying to lead her off this path. Like, they know that she's heading this way, and they want to veer her off, and they're using Tom to do it. But he's not successful at all. He's totally unsuccessful.
No. And, yeah, he's really a poor he's really a poor agent. I don't...
Well...
Although...
You know, and he said that, you know, that's his job. He's supposed to love her, like, you know, love her. But, you know, I don't know. I'm wondering what the rest of his job is. I mean, that's a pretty deep undercover job.
It is. And, of course, you know, where was this little affair thing going? Was the fact that she could pull him away, like, a test of that, you know, to see where he is in this process, that, hey, you know, your job,
losing sight.
Right. Your job isn't to get frustrated. Your job is to keep tabs.
Right.
And get her off of this, you know, get your butt back in gear. But I don't think so. I think Jolene is.
I don't think so either.
I think she's a third party.
Yeah, I think so too.
But well, she,
whether or not she's working on her own or working with someone else, you know, maybe. I mean, that's something that hopefully will be revealed later.
Right. But it's also in her best interest to make Tom think that she's on the same team.
Oh yeah.
So right now, right this minute. Tom. All Tom knows is that she knows that Liz is the target, and that's it. So, but she's going to use, you know, Tom and probably Liz in that to get to Red.
Yeah.
So is she working on her own, or is she working for now a fourth party? Boy, this is confusing.
Oh, there's so much stuff going on. I mean, it's like every week we don't know what's going to happen next.
I know. And that's the big thing. And we haven't even got to the judge.
I know. And the judge seemed inconsequential to everything else that was going on. You know, the judge, I mean, you know,
well,
they don't know at first who it is. And then, you know, what's her name? Weir. Is that her last name?
Yeah. But yeah, this is a thing that's been going on for at least 20 some odd years, that the judge grants prisoners like a new review of the case. Now,
yeah,
if it finds out that you were innocent and you spent 12 years, then, you know, whoever doctored... Whoever puts you in there, but not just anybody, the person that left out the details that could have set you free.
Right.
It's not just
they get punished the same way the other person was punished. So if you spend 12 years, then she's going to keep you captive for 12 years. And that's how it started out. That's how, you know, we see that Rivkin walking down the street, you know, and he's looks like a homeless person.
Yeah.
And they're like...
So we find out this guy is Mark Hastings, and he's actually a federal prosecutor.
Oh yeah, that's what it was.
And Leonard Debs was the guy that he was investigating, and he got 2 years taken off of his sentence, so Mark got 2 years off of his too.
Mm-hmm.
And of course, did they explain how that these guys lost their mind? Kind of like in that time, like being held in a horse stable was any more mentally taxing than a federal prison.
Right.
But, yeah, they're maybe they explained that process. Maybe they didn't, but however, you know, it's this whole underground court of appeals and they get to Frank Gordon.
Yeah.
Of course, the entire time you see that scene with the flashlight going out, coming back on, going out, and so it goes out and it finally pops back on. Of course, we knew that was going to happen. There's Frank's face, and you know he gives the agent wrestler a pop in the face and then runs off.
Yeah.
So then we find out that Tom Connolly and Agent Cooper, who we were just complaining about on the last episode.
Right.
You know, that they're dirty in this case. You know, Agent Cooper beat the... he beat the defendant, tried to get a confession. Connolly ordered it. And so not only are they not worried that now that they're targets, but they're trying to keep Agent Liz Keene, trying to get her off of it, off the trail, and say, look, you know, worry about your job here.
Right.
So it's just funny that, you know they're trying to legitimize Cooper, but at the same time, Cooper's dirty.
Yeah, and I like how Liz, like, she accuses accuses him of beating a confession out of Rivkin. You know, she, you know, gets in his face and is like, you know.
Oh yeah, I mean, you really can't get around the fact that Liz is basically not only her boss, but her boss's boss.
Yeah.
And you know that, look, you know, this is gonna come out.
Yeah, I mean, flashback to, Rifkin being strapped to a gurney and that he dies and accusing Cooper of Connolly in his last breath, and they leave the execution, and he says, you know, someday you're gonna be attorney general, you know.
Yeah.
So.
So, you know, at this point, we know they're going to get theirs. But somehow they're saved. So how did they keep the judge from exacting revenge on Connolly and Cooper?
Well, Reddington shows up, and Liz asks for Red's help after he gets taken, you know, and Reddington kind of does his own thing. He goes visits a guy named Richard in a Navy uniform. Richard many years ago. They were roommates at the Naval Academy.
Uh-huh.
Red wants to know how much Richard knows about the incident, you know, and then at the farm, Red shows up and lectures the judge about what, you know, righteous person she is. And he convinces her to give herself up.
So, I don't... Of course, you know, and I think we, on episode 14 also, you know, this didn't seem like, I'm not getting why that the judge was on the list. I mean, the judge seems pretty much like a fairly righteous criminal, you know, as much like Red feels like he is, you know, Red isn't just in about, you know, the black and white of criminal or not criminal. You know, that there is justice, and the judge is, you know, she was serving justice, you know, for the innocent.
How does she get on the list?
Right. How does she get on the list? I think.
Like, she's like taking it into her own hands to get the bad, you know, these people who are supposed to be the good guys. You know, putting people in prison wrongfully, and she's like exacting an eye for an eye revenge.
Right, which is right up Red's alley. So, mm-hmm. You know, but, you know, getting these people off the list benefit Red, I mean, directly. It's, you know, it's his, you know, this whole thing is directing some major thing, but I really don't see how this, you know, other than the mythical character of the judge,
right,
and just checking some random kind of, you know, background, like this person has operated in the shadows for so long, everybody thinks it's a myth, but to what end?
She gets taken into custody. Maybe he's going to use her later.
That's you know? About the only thing I can think of. So. Yeah.
You know, because he didn't kill her. You know?
Yeah.
So.
So, we get back to Tom and Jolene, and when Jolene's got lots of, she's got lots of little targets. So, we're going to have a chase kind of between... Jolene and Red, they've finally taken Tom out of the shadows. We've got, you know, confirmation. Now we know for sure those little annoying puppy dog eyes and hurt and forlorn looks are pretty much, you know, what we thought they were. Totally, yeah. Totally fake.
Yep. That he's so, playing her.
Yeah, and, you know, I do hope that they answer some of these questions. You know, I'm kind of glad we did the 31 questions because I think these are the I think these are all the elements, all the major elements that are just, you know, about to be answered. And we've got you know, Red's kind of new investigator. I think he's going to come back. I think, what are they going to do with Tom and Jolene at this point? Because the cat's out of the bag.
Yeah.
So.
Well, I saw the preview for you know, next week, and I'm really excited. There's going to be some showdown action.
Okay. So what's going on there? What are we going to be seeing?
Well, what I saw, or what I remember seeing that stood out the most was Tom and Jolene totally in a drag out fight. He was like throwing her all over the place.
Oh, geez.
Yeah, so I'm really excited about that. Oh, and they're in some sort of warehouse, so I don't know. There was someone else there too, and I can't remember who it was exactly, but like, yeah, Tom totally gets his game on. We totally get to see him in action.
All right. I've got a couple things I really have to do. So do we want to wrap this one up, or do you want to? All right.
No, let's wrap it up.
All right. So I guess that takes us to the end of this show, and we're going to look for the next fireworks on episode 16. I think we're all looking forward to. So this has been the SMG Blacklist podcast, brought to you by the Southgate Media Group. Our Twitter is
at the Blacklist Pod.
Mine is at J1 Grosky.
And mine is at MS Maxi.
And don't forget to do those reviews. I guess we got a couple five-star reviews on iTunes. We could use some more. But go to the SouthgateMediaGroup.com website. Click on our banners. And up until next time, we'll see you on the list.
See you then.
If you would like to donate to help pay for this and other Southgate Media Group podcasts, simply go to our website, southgatemediagroup.com, and click on the donate button. It can be as little as a dollar or, well, as much as you want. Help keep this fun going by supporting this and our other shows. Thanks again for listening, everyone. You're the best fans in the world.